Now it gives me great pleasure to hand over to Reverend Michael Reckord, who will conduct the rest of this morning's service. Please give him a wonderful welcome.
Thank you very much, Sharon, for the introduction. Thank you especially for that really beautiful birthday blessing. I do not think that I have had a lovelier one in all that I have received over the many years. Good morning, friends. Top of the morning to you who are worshiping here at the Temple of Light, Center for Spiritual Living, in bright, beautiful, warm, very warm Kingston, Jamaica, as well as to you listening to me online. Today I want to share a few thoughts on this thing called consciousness. I first heard of the concept of consciousness when I started coming to this church about 18 years ago. Wow, that long. And I regard that concept as perhaps the single most important one of our teaching. You see, you can sum up science of mind, for newcomers, by the way, that's the name of our teaching, science of mind, also called religious science. You can sum up the teaching with this simple statement: our consciousness, which is our thinking, determines the condition of our lives. Our consciousness determines the condition of our lives. People hearing that for the first time might not believe it. They might think that it is the condition of our lives, where we live, who our friends are, our education, whether we are rich or poor, that sort of thing. It is the condition of our lives that determines what and how we think, not the other way around. So I say to them and to everybody else that just as physical exercise changes your body, so too does exercising your brain change your brain physically. And if your brain changes, you think differently. I think that's obvious. Talking about brain change, as I was doing some research on it, I Googled this title, The Brains of London Taxi Drivers. I'd heard about a research, and up popped this article. I read it as it is on the internet. The structure of a London taxi driver's brain changes during the grueling process of learning the quickest way around the capital, scans have revealed. MRI scans. Dozens of trainee drivers had MRI scans before and after they acquired what is called the knowledge, which is memorizing hundreds of journeys and street names. The University College of London team, writing in Current Biology, the magazine, found brain parts linked to memory grew bigger. They said it proved that the brain could adapt to new tasks, even in adulthood. Earlier studies of the brain of the cabbie had already noted the increase in gray matter. This is in the hippocampus, an area found at the base of the brain. However, this current research tried to work out if the change had happened during the intensive learning period prior to starting work or on the job itself. So they scanned the brains of 79 trainees just before they started the All London Knowledge, which can take between 2 and 4 years to complete. You see, would-be taxi drivers have to learn 320 routes within a 6-mile radius of Charing Cross, you know it well, which covers a mind-boggling 25,000 streets and 20,000 landmarks and places of interest. Throughout the process, any changes to the cabbies' brains were mapped by the MRI scans. Compared to with similar scans from non-taxi drivers, those who had attempted the knowledge had increased the size of the posterior hippocampus, the rear section of the hippocampus, which lies at the front of the brain. Professor Eleanor Maguire, who led the study, said, I quote, "The human brain remains plastic, even in adult life, allowing it to adapt when we learn new tasks. This offers encouragement for adults who want to learn new skills later in life." Full stop, unquote. So you see, you can teach an old dog new tricks. Old people too. As I said, since there's a close relationship between brains and thinking, if our brains change, then it follows that our thinking changes. But as talking about consciousness, is thinking the same as consciousness? Not quite. Consciousness is the sum total of, the end result of, our habitual thoughts, attitudes, feelings, and emotions. Ernest Holmes, the founder of religious science, calls consciousness, I quote, "the atmosphere of our thoughts," unquote. On page 142 of his magnum opus, which is our main textbook called The Science of Mind, he writes, I quote, "We are all immersed in the atmosphere of our own thinking, which is the direct result of all we have ever said, thought, or done. This decides what is to take place in our lives. Thought attracts what is like itself and repels what is unlike." Full stop, unquote. He's there referring to the law of attraction. More on that law later. In the glossary of the science of mind, Dr. Holmes describes the two modes of consciousness. He calls them the objective and the subjective. I quote, "Objective consciousness is a state of consciousness, conscious awareness, equipped with will, decision, and discrimination. It has self-choice. The subjective consciousness is entirely a reaction to this objective volition. It is creative, but not discriminative. It is, of course, conscious, but it is not self-conscious." In other words, objective consciousness is what I would call the top consciousness, the self-aware one that you are using right now as you listen to me, while the subjective consciousness is the subconsciousness, the one we are not directly aware of. So there is objective on top and there is subjective, the subconscious. The two are connected, of course. There is one mind. And one consciousness feeds the other continuously. Both influence the body directly, and both influence the people, conditions, and events around us indirectly. The important point that Dr. Holmes is making is that while the self-conscious or top mind can evaluate and choose among a number of messages that it can send to the subconscious can't evaluate them, can't discriminate among those messages. It accepts as true all messages, even negative, self-harming ones, sent to it by the self-conscious mind, and it acts upon them. If, for example, you consciously evaluate yourself and decide that you are an unlovable person, when the self-evident truth is that the infinite powerful source loves you, if you do that, your subconscious will accept the decision and will act upon it. You'll find yourself thinking and speaking and behaving in a way that causes people not to love you. If you consciously tell yourself that, despite the incontrovertible fact that you are connected to an infinitely abundant universe, just look around you. If you tell yourself that your world is one of lack and poverty, your subconscious will accept that falsehood as the truth and will act accordingly. You will be drawn more and more into what you perceive as poverty. As Dr. Holmes points out on that same page, 142, I quote, "We are drawn toward those things which we mentally image. Most of our inner processes of our thoughts have been unconscious, but when we understand the law, we learn to consciously embody what we wish and think of this only, and then we are drawn silently toward it." Unquote. There is something else very important about the subconscious or subjective mind that Dr. Holmes reveals in the glossary. It is this: our individual subconscious mind is not individual at all. It is part of universal mind, the infinite creative mind of God itself. That is why when we put a belief into the subconscious mind, the entire universe conspires to uphold it. You see, it is one thing to casually say to somebody asking for a handout, I'm broke, or to tell that to yourself at the top consciousness level. But when that message reaches your subconscious, which can't discriminate, it also reaches the universal creative mind, and that mind has to act on the messages. If you weren't broke before, you will be shortly. Unless, of course, you counteract the message with a different thought. Sometimes God, to use the popular name for creative mind, sometimes God leads you along a path which is puzzling for a while. It happened to me over the summer during my holiday in New York City. I go there every August to see some good plays and to see my children, not necessarily in that order. I often speak to my children about God, and a few weeks ago I had reason to remind my son, with whom I was staying, that the universe supports us in whatever we want to do. In fact, a mere intention is sometimes enough to trigger the support. In other words, you don't have to try. You can just intend, and the universe starts to adjust itself to support you. And my talk with my son arose from a curious incident earlier that day. As I was dressing to go and see a play, which began at 4 p.m., the phone rang. It was my sister calling from Maryland. And when the call ended some 20 minutes later, I could see that I was running late. Anyway, I set out for the bus stop. And as I turned the corner, guess what? The bus I wanted drove past. I missed it by 1 minute and had to wait maybe 15 minutes more to get the other bus. By then, I was almost positive I'd be late. The second leg of the journey was on the subway. And by the time I got off a few blocks from the theater, my watch was saying 4 o'clock, starting time. I was late. I couldn't get in. The theater has a sign saying, no latecomers will be admitted. I knew it. But for some reason, instead of going to another theater to see another show, as I could have, it was still early, I set out for the original theater. It took me 10 minutes to reach it. And as I walked, I kept asking myself why I was bothering to go. It was the strangest feeling. I reached the theater, saw the sign on the door, no latecomers admitted, as I knew I would have. But instead of going back, I kept walking to the end of the street. There, I could turn right, I could turn left. I was going nowhere in particular at that stage. I turned right. By chance, I thought. Except that after walking a few yards, I came upon a store I had been wanting to find from my visit a year before. I was, of course, delighted, even surprised, but I was not amazed. I was saying to myself, so that is why I was late, why my sister called at that time, why I missed my bus. That's why I kept walking. I had wanted to find the store, and though that day I was not consciously thinking about it, the desire was in my mind at a subconscious level, the level of universal creative mind. It had been leading me on. Thanks to the great psychoanalyst Sigmund Freud and to Dr. Holmes, we now know that we can be thinking of different things, even conflicting things, at the two levels of our minds. That helps to explain why unexpected things happen to us, whether good or bad. If something negative happens when we are thinking positive thoughts and we believe in the law of attraction, we might wonder why. We're thinking positive, yet this negative thing has a... Now, it could be, we now know, that subconsciously we might have had some negative consciousness. But don't get me wrong. I'm not saying we definitely were thinking negatively at that particular time, at the subconscious level. The event, you see, might not have been negative at all. It might only appear to be negative at that time. For example, I thought that being late for the play was negative. But if I had not been late, I'd not have found the store. Universal mind knew I preferred to find the store than to go to that particular play that day. I went to another play the next day and the day after that. I love the theater. I see about a dozen plays in New York every summer. I said that thanks to Freud, we now know about the subconscious mind. Incidentally, Freud preferred the term unconscious. He didn't like subconscious, and he explains why. And we can now understand consciousness as a whole a little better, thanks to our knowledge of that there is this subconscious. But of course, the word conscious is almost interchangeable with the word character. And we humans have been talking and writing about character for thousands of years. For example, many of Jesus' parables are about character / consciousness. The main character in The Prodigal Son has a materialistic, selfish type of consciousness at first, and he suffers for it. Then, when he changes his consciousness to one of humility and love, his fortunes change. That's what Jesus was pointing out in the parable. In the Good Samaritan, we see that the Samaritan, though he's regarded as an outsider by the Jews, has a consciousness of love for humanity, which Jesus teaches we should all have. The consciousness of the foolish virgins, you'll remember them. They don't have oil in their lamps. And their consciousness is obvious from the title of the parable, as is the parable of the persistent widow who insists that a judge give her justice. Let's examine in some detail the consciousness of the title character of the parable of the unmerciful servant found in Matthew chapter 18. In that parable, Jesus compares the kingdom of heaven to the situation of a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. I quote, "As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. 'Be patient with me,' he begged, 'and I will pay back everything.' The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins, as opposed to the gold, grabbed him and began to choke him. 'Pay back what you owe,' he demanded. His fellow servant fell on his knees and begged him, 'Be patient with me and I will pay it back.' But he refused. Instead, he went off, had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. The master called the servant in. 'You wicked servant,' he said. 'I canceled all the debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?' In anger, the master handed the servant over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed." Jesus concludes the parable with this warning, I quote, "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart," unquote. Of course, it is inconceivable that God would literally treat us the way the master treats the unmerciful servant. God doesn't torture us. Jesus, of course, is speaking figuratively. The torture must be self-induced. Jesus is saying that until we forgive those who trespass against us, from our hearts, meaning from the depths of our being, from our subconsciousness, if you wish, until we forgive them, we will be emotionally tortured. And we know how corrosive a consciousness of unforgiveness is. Some of us know from personal experience, some from seeing the effects on others. And we've all heard the saying that being unforgiving is like taking poison and expecting the other person to feel the ill effects. When I talk to my son about how God works, I always refer to The Secret, that best-selling film, later published as a book, of some years ago. Most of you have probably seen the movie, I suspect. If you haven't, you should. Go to thesecret.tv and you will get further information. The Secret is about consciousness too, but it presents the topic much more dramatically than I could in this talk. To remind those who have seen it and to inform those who have not, here are the main points on how we can live happy, successful lives. 1, the law of attraction is one of the most powerful spiritual laws. It states basically that like attracts like. That is, thinking and acting positively attracts positive things into your life. Literally, says The Secret, thoughts become things. Your mind determines your universe. Two, while negative thoughts become things too, positive thoughts are 100 times more powerful than negative ones. This is because of the nature of the universe, which is supportive. So you don't have to worry too much about fleeting negative thoughts. The ones you worry about are the ones that remain with you. Three, if you've ever puzzled about what sort of consciousness you have, you're not quite sure. All you need to do is look at your life. The conditions in your life, good or bad, were attracted by your consciousness. It could have been by default. That is, it could have been by your subconscious rather than by your conscious mind. And remember, your subconscious is part of race mind, which you don't have direct control of. So if there's a lot of negative stuff floating around in race mind and you're not careful, it could affect your own conditions of your life. Number four, your thoughts cause emotions. And the two fundamental emotions or feelings are good feelings and bad feelings. Try always to feel good, because the universe responds to feelings more easily than to anything else. That is to say, responds to feelings more quickly than it responds to actions, more quickly than it responds to thoughts, to words, etc. Feelings is what the universe latches onto directly. Five, you can attract big things into your life as easily as you can attract small things. The universe does not distinguish between big and small. Think how vast the universe is. Everything is, you know, the same to it. And the universe always says yes to your request. The genie in The Secret says, "Your wish is my command." You might remember that. Point six, The Secret recommends that you focus on what you want, not on what you don't want, not on how you're going to get it. The universe, you see, has more ways than you can imagine of getting what you want to you. So don't try to tell the universe how to do its business. Just tell the universe what you want. Nine, keep a gratitude list. Melody Beatty, in an email that I got from Carmen, she sends thoughts of the day every day. Melody Beatty puts this matter of gratitude very well. She says, I quote, "Gratitude turns what we have into enough and more. It turns denial into acceptance, chaos into order, confusion into clarity. It makes sense of our past, brings peace for today, and creates a vision for tomorrow." Gratitude. And finally, you should visualize to materialize. In other words, keep a clear picture in your mind of what you want. Perhaps you could keep a vision board of pictures and drawings from magazines and newspapers. That helps. And I'll close with a blog on consciousness from New Thought luminary Dr. Carol Kahn's, who we heard from earlier. Sharon read the inspirational reading. This blog is aimed particularly at helping people whose consciousness have attracted unwanted conditions into their lives. I quote, "There is an inner world and an outer world. Our problems arise when we focus on only one of them, specifically the outer. Without some awareness of the vast inner life we have, we are easily convinced that what we see in the outer has some power of its own to continue. In truth, Nothing can replicate itself without the energy of consciousness infused into it. It may last for a bit, but will dissipate if our focus shifts away from it. That is why in spiritual mind treatment, for the newcomers, spiritual mind treatment is our form of, we call it scientific prayer or affirmative prayer. That is why in spiritual mind treatment, we turn completely away from the problem or condition and focus instead on the truth of our being, the source within us. What is the truth of our being? Simply that the cause of the outer world exists in the inner realm of consciousness. Everything begins in mind as an idea before it can reveal itself as a thing, a situation, or an experience. The trouble, of course, comes when we are not conscious of the ideas we are holding. That is why we are advised to meditate and keep our minds open to the good, the true, and the beautiful. Fear comes from misjudging what we see. If we know that it is all a temporary manifestation of previous ideas, and that a new idea, felt with conviction, will override the process and act as cause to a new effect, then fear dies away, and we are free to claim our good. Unquote. The universe supports you, friends, so keep happy. Good will follow. Namaste.